But I do want to say, and I'm going to start with our master of photography, if Mary will permit me, that Stephen happened to do a fabulous interview with Alex Soff in the Financial Times. That's product placement, one of our sponsors. Not really. No, really, it's a terrific interview. It's a terrific interview, very funny. And I must admire Alex's enthusiasm for, I felt he was like draining like a sponge for ideas which will lead him forward.
Yeah, well, you know, sometimes there's this idea of a conversation in print. Yeah. And because we all have fascinating conversations with friends at dinner. And often in print it falls flat. And this one with Alec really worked.
Yeah,
it,
absolutely.
It seemed to me to be what that kind of format was meant to be.
So I feel guilty not having more of the talks, photographer to photographer now, but next year. On the occasion of your MOMA retrospective, 2017, and on this Photo London occasion, it's an opportunity for you to look back and think about the future too. And you mentioned a teacher, in the interview with Alex, you mentioned a teacher very early in your life who said, if you want to be a real artist and you have an exhibition, you can't just let that be the satisfaction that it would appear to be. You have to look beyond that. It's what comes next. Could you just comment a bit about that, well, in terms of this experience?
Yeah. Well, that's in fact how the main part of this exhibition came about. I was having the retrospective in MoMA, and I've done enough shows in my life to know that, especially when there's a big show, and this covered 60 years of work, that there's always the feeling afterward of, oh God, now what am I going to do? And I thought the way to solve that was to start a new project a half a year before the show opened. And that's what I'm still working on, and that's what's being shown here.
So, just to follow up on that, have you seen the installation
yes.
here? Is that going to lead to anything? Does that suggest something else? Another door?
The installation
yeah,
itself?
Yeah. When you see it installed in this way, in this place?
I don't know yet, because I just saw it yesterday. But the pictures, because of... I rarely worked in this scale before. Because of their scale, it's very different seeing them in real life than as a JPEG or on the display of the camera. And so every time I see them in real life, I learn from it. And we have another exhibition, a little bit larger of the same work, at Sprutmacher's in LA this summer. But it's a project I'm continuing on. And so every time I show it, that feeds my understanding of what I'm doing with it.
Mary.
Can I just ask a quick question?
Yes, of course.
When you're photographing on your projects, are you shooting on the same cameras in the same way? Or
no, this is a new camera.
Are you not shooting film or
no.
digital?
It's digital.
Okay.
And in fact, when I started the project, the camera had just been released about 3 months before, and I felt that it was capable of taking a picture that couldn't have been taken a year before. Mm-hmm. But I wasn't interested in that as a gimmick. I was interested in that as, this is new aesthetic territory.
Yeah.
And that's a theme which comes back in everything you do, this
new
aesthetic territory.
That's going to be the subject of my talk tomorrow with David Campany. We're going to talk about how tools affect photography.
We won't talk about
that
now,
then. Before about how on our Instagram, I really like Stephen's Instagram because it's similar to mine. He takes pictures on his phone and uploads them rather than doing lots of our exhibition pictures as a showcase. It's more of a sort of mini exhibition.
And how do you feel, Mary, about, have you seen the installation now?
I've only seen it on, I literally got here and came here, so I'm going to be going
right.
there next.
So,
only in pictures.
And how did the concept come to you? Why this body of work? It's the Royal Ballet,
mm-hmm.
right?
I basically have been friends with Michael and Fariba for the whole of Photo London. I've been meeting with them and looking for an opportunity to show with them. And they came to me a few months ago and showed me a mock-up using my off-point ballet pictures from the Royal Ballet behind the scenes, quite gritty, quite sort of showing the other side of the lifestyle of being a ballet dancer. And they'd also mocked up Paris Nude, which is my latest book, which is a nude series, and the nude wasn't so appropriate for a public space. So. And I haven't really shown, even though I took the photo off-point pictures in 2004, I haven't really exhibited them. I kind of collect pictures and they go into my archive, but I haven't really exhibited them to the public. So it's, for me, as you say, the scale is really interesting because it's floor to ceiling at the west side of the pavilion. And also it's about interacting with the viewer and the public, and I just want to be here now sort of meeting the public and getting their reaction, because it's about taking this subject was going into like the ballet dancers' homes, bathrooms, bedrooms, backstage, and then bringing it out to show it to the viewer so that there's a connection between.
A lot of your work is commissioned. You've done a lot of commissions, Vogue, and GQ, and so on, half and half. Which gives you the most satisfaction? Is that too simplistic? No, it isn't.
It's a good question, but the answer is it depends, both of them. The ballet was a sort of, it's about adventure, and it's about, commissions are amazing, because some of them will phone me and say, will you take pictures of Orlando Bloom in Los Angeles, and I'll find a house, and we'll have, like, hang around and have a day of photographing together. But, for instance, Off Point, that's shown here, came about because I was asked to exhibit at the Floral Ball at the Royal Ballet, at the Royal Opera House where the ballet school is and they perform. So that then I approached the Royal Ballet and said, can I go behind the scenes with the dancers? So that really, it's the unknown is what I love about what I do. So it's,
are you a little nervous about the scale?
No, I love the scale.
You love the scale?
I love the scale. Because I was shown it on the mock-ups. I was inspired by like Stephen's work or, you know, Cortez or, you know, the real classic, Gary Winogrand, the normal fine art photography scale. But now I worked on an exhibition with my mum's with some of the first Chiclet prints, and we blew them up to like 4 foot. And so the scale I love, because you can kind of walk, when you're looking at the pictures, you can sort of fall into them and see things that you don't see in a smaller scale. When you blow something up, it's sort of a landscape to look at, and so you will look at things in a different way.
So a question for both of you then, where are you happiest to see your work? And let me preface that with, so Cartier Bresson thought the rightful place for the photograph is in the book. Edward Tinsky says the rightful place for the photograph is on the wall. That's where he puts his energy. Stephen, how does that read to you?
It depends.
When I'm on any assignment, a standalone picture on the wall, I think that's just what inspired me first, was going to exhibitions and now sort of falling in love with certain images on the wall. So I've always imagined, whether it's in a gallery, a museum, or in someone's home, a collector, I imagine a standalone image that will arrest somebody's attention and that will kind of, like a moving still in a way, to catch one moment that will engage somebody's attention for a long time.
So in the Paris Nude, for example, would the ideal format, the ideal result be a book and an exhibition?
Yeah.
Because
it's a study. I went and stayed with this woman who's actually, it was an accidental. I sent a text to this woman because she has a great figure and a little black bob, and she's Chinese American. I said, I've got an idea for a photo story for us to do together, kiss, kiss, kiss. She thought I wanted to do a triple X rated nude story, which wasn't the intention. So I ended up I did the other project with her, but we planned for me to go to her apartment in Paris, and I spent 2 days following her around. So that became a study which has a lot of vignettes to it. But then I still was always thinking of standalone images within those different stories.
But I imagine when you're shooting for Instagram, you, as I do, are thinking about how the image is going to look on a display this size.
On a phone, yeah.
Can we go right back to the very beginning? You say some wonderful things in that interview. with Alex about starting at 8 and 10, 12.
Because I grew up in a very artistic family, and my mother was a photographer, and it actually took being with a friend of mine looking through her holiday pictures, which was so badly composed and badly taken, to actually realize not everybody has a photographic eye. And that's when I phoned my mum, and I was like, I'm gonna take it up. And she gave me a Leica R7, and
wow,
the rest
that's it.
Carries on from there. But I think the similarity in our work is looking for, looking in the everyday and like observing in a certain way, finding moments that aren't, like looking at life and catching it so that the viewer then comes into our life, imagining. So do you, I mean, I imagine the viewer when I'm photographing usually at some point.
I'm not sure I do, but I know that that what you're saying about the everyday is absolutely true. And there's something about, it doesn't take a huge leap of imagination to photograph something spectacular, but to pay attention to, just to pay attention to life.
Well, like a picture, one of your pictures is like a chair in a cafe, sort of how the light is hitting it, whereas probably everyone else, a lot of people walk into the same location and they're like thinking about something else, but you know, the light and color.
There's an unfortunate word, banal, which is often used. And uncommon, I think, is a much more evocative and ambiguous and open word. Uncommon.
But every day is kind of interesting and exciting, and things that happen naturally rather than building a set or casting somebody, to me, is really interesting. And the non-manicured, I think, is really kind of what we're in search of.
Yeah, and just the activity of going through life, paying attention to what you see.
I mean, being able to just wander and take pictures and look is kind of pretty. Also, can I say I'm really excited because you took a picture with my studio manager in and that has made her life.
Just, Stephen, people here interested in color. Look back on your work as seminal. You were with other people at the time, certainly. There was a movement that I remember it vividly because I just started photography at that point. How it was quite a sensational moment and a shock as people had to deal with black and white as not the be-all and end-all. There was the bias of commerce. Color was commercial and therefore had to be taken away. Do you feel there was a moment where you sensed that the Royal Ballet is black and white?
Yes.
And most of your commissions are color?
Well, the Royal Ballet, I shot it on my own with, and I had a bag of film and my camera, whereas some of my bigger commissions I'll have an assistant and I'll use sort of continuous lighting, like film lighting, if I'm doing a bigger that needs light, if it's evening. But so I had to make a decision to load the camera. Am I going to use color, black and white? And I decided black and white for a practical reason that not knowing what I was going to be in so many situations from a lighting point of view, like to get away from the tungsten and things, but also to make it, I think what you touched on, so the viewers, when they look at them, the images look very, they could be taken in any era. But when you look at them, there are little signs like one's called Cinderella Converse, where she's got a towel and she's doing up her Converse trainers, but she's got all her ballet makeup and tiara on. So it was to then allow space for the viewer to fill in a lot of gaps and sort of make it more interactive. And I like the quality of that really grainy black and white contrast.
And your nude is both, Paris nude is both black and white.
Yeah, I had two cameras,
right.
I had.
Right. I'm afraid we're running out of time. Can I ask you a last question? Are you optimistic about what you see the photography world is? Are you optimistic?
I'm glad you specified the photography world.
Yeah.
Well, no,
the
world.
I'm actually not particularly optimistic about it. But the photography world, I teach, I've taught for almost 40 years, and young photographers say, there's nothing new that can be photographed. And I've heard people say that, I remember 40 years ago, 45 years ago, people saying that. And someone comes along and has a new vision.
Kick them out of the school when they say that. Just go. I think that's the solution. We're going to have to end it there. I know you all want to visit the fair, so thank you very much, and thank you very much, Mary and Stephen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Just a quick note to say I'm